Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Feliz Sábado.
Feliz Sábado.
Bon Sabbat.
Bon Sabbat.
Any other languages?
Shabbat
Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
I tell you something. I feel like a little boy who was warned not to interfere with a barrel filled with molasses.
Yes. Yes.
And the little boy couldn't resist the temptation of molasses. He just loved it. And he would stand on a little elevation,
yes,
and put his hand down in the barrel and lick the molasses. Daddy said, "Don't you do that again, otherwise you're going to be in trouble with me." One day, Dad was not present, and the little boy climbed up again and began to do the same thing, lost his equilibrium, and fell headward down into the barrel of molasses. And Dad came just about at the right time, grabbed him by his little feet, pulled him out, molasses running all down, he's licking, his hands licking everywhere. And the daddy began to scold him. He looked up in his daddy's face and said, "Oh, Dad, I wish I had tongue equal to the occasion." I feel just like that little boy today. You know, just listening to you men sing does something for anybody. What an inspiration. And I thought as I listened to Claude singing that number that I wish I were a few years younger and still in evangelism. I would take him along with me.
Amen.
And we'll sing and preach and bring men and women to the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
What a joy to be here this morning.
Amen.
Welcome to all of you, and I hope we have a great time together here today.
Amen.
I like your theme here. Last night, we went through the storm, and we found out that God has made a provision for us to come through the storm successfully. Our message was, God is
able.
Oh, wow. You know, I feel like going back in the classroom again. Good students. God is able to do what?
Save
us. And when he saves us, he saves us for good. Secondly, God is able to help us. In all of our infirmities, he lifts us up and makes us one in Christ Jesus. God is able to keep us from falling. So there is no reason for us to fall. Praise God. Because he is able to keep us from falling. Then we concluded by emphasizing the most essential of it all, that God is able to establish us.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that a wonderful group of students?
Mm-hmm.
Of Aaron?
Mm-hmm.
So he saves us, he helps us, he keeps us, and he establishes us. And I long for the day when I'll have the joy of seeing all of you without the loss of one.
Mm-hmm.
Fully established to see the Master face to face. Now, for this morning, we are going to get into the subject for the day. And I notice here, bound to what?
Revival.
Listen, one of the greatest needs of the men of God's church today is revival.
Amen.
So I'm going to give you, from the Word of God, some secrets to achieve revival. What do you say?
Amen.
Turn with me to the book of 1 Samuel. And I'm going to invite the good students here this morning, because what I'm going to do is a little exposition on one verse.
Mm.
One verse. And it is 1 Samuel chapter 10 and verse 26. 1 Samuel 10, 26. And I'm reading from the King James Version. And it says, "And Saul went home to Gibeah, and there went with him a band of men whose hearts God had touched." You like that?
Yeah.
They went home with Saul, a band of men, whose hearts God had what?
Touched.
When God touches us, we are never the same again. Let me give you, first of all, the background, the context, so we can appreciate the message. You know, we teach in homiletics that a text without a context is a pretext. So we want to have a context so we can understand the message. What is this verse telling us? Come with me a long time in the past. And a young man named Saul was chosen from looking after the farm life to become the first king of Israel. Samuel the prophet anointed him. And in the anointing, he gave him a series of instructions. You'll find these instructions in chapter 10, which we have just looked at, verse 6, verse 7, verse 8, and verse 9. Instructions there. And among the things that Samuel told Saul was that when God touched him and anointed him to become the king of Israel, he would be changed into another man.
Yes. Amen.
That's the setting.
Yes.
Now, so you notice here that that change did take place, because the verse says here in verse 26, and Saul went home to Gibeah, and there went with him a band of men. I like that, don't you?
Yeah.
A band of what?
Men.
Whose hearts God had touched. In today's message, I'd like to emphasize three things that happen when God touches our lives. Put them down. Number one, when God touches our lives, there is transformation. In other words, He does not. When He touches us, we are never the same again. The Spirit of the Lord will come upon you, and you will be changed into another man. That's a powerful verse, isn't it?
Yeah.
Verse 6. Changed into another man. This is what I call spiritual metamorphosis.
Yeah.
You came to this campground a certain man, you go back a different man.
Yeah.
Change in your direction, amen?
Yeah.
New men with new hearts.
Yeah.
New motivations. New perspectives. New direction. New attitude, a new mission, and a new destiny. And I feel in my heart today that at the end of this great convention here, men are going to go back to their churches, their homes, their families, their communities, transformed, brand new men. And they went with him a band of men whose hearts God had touched. God is not in the business of cosmetic transformation. I like to tell people that God is a heart transplanter. He changes the heart, not just the appearance. Now, in this country, people spend billions of dollars to change how they look. But God wants us here this morning, my brothers, to leave this place with a transformation of life and heart.
Yes.
Fully surrendered to the Lord Jesus Christ. What do you say?
Amen.
God is not in the business of behavior modification.
Yes.
But in the business of transformation of life and heart. What do you say?
Amen.
Thank God that He is a heart surgeon.
Yes.
Long before they began to do transplants, God had done that. And has continued to do it today. And I can take time here to tell you over and over again of men whose hearts have been changed because of the preaching of the gospel. The word of God changes, what do you say? So you're going to leave here transformed. Remember this. I like this passage. It's found in Ezekiel chapter 11 and verse 19. I will take away the stony heart and will give you what?
A heart of flesh.
those cold hearts, those calculating hearts, those insensitive hearts, those sinful hearts, our God is able to transform us, change our hearts, and send us back home with tender, sensitive, pliable, loving hearts. May that be so for all of us, what do you say?
Amen.
A long time after King Saul, another Saul came on the stage.
Yeah.
And God changed him.
Amen.
If you remember, he was known as Saul, is that right?
Yes.
And when God entered his life, he was transformed so totally that he became what?
Paul.
Yes. I've made a little something here I want to share with you. Saul, the bitter antagonist, became Paul, the eloquent apologist of the gospel.
Amen.
Saul, the bigot, became Paul, the apostle of reconciliation, the defender of the faith. And he wrote at one time a magnificent passage. Let me share it with you. It is found in Romans 12 and verse 2. Be ye transformed by what? The renewing of your mind. I said earlier that God is not in the business of behavior transformation.
Yes.
He is in the business of the transformation of our mind.
Yes.
And our prayer should be, Lord, give me the mind of Jesus.
Yes.
As a husband, as a father, as a church member, as an employer, as an employee, give me the mind of Jesus. That's the message that God has for us today. Amen? So, that is very important, and I want you to remember this, that the divine touch is still transformational today.
Yes.
Isn't that wonderful?
Uh-huh.
The Spirit of the Lord will come upon you in power, the verse says, at verses 6 and 7 of 1 Samuel 10. The Spirit of the Lord will come upon you with what? Power. You know, there are several words in the New Testament translated power. One is exousia, meaning authority. The other is dunamis, meaning what?
Strength.
Dynamite. This reminds me of my favorite preacher, H.M.S. Richard Sr. Went to Chile one day, and he was in a little church preaching, and noticed that right in front of him, there was a pulpit made of discarded lumber, box, and it was marked explosion here. Explosion. That's what the church is all about, explosion.
Mm.
Amen?
Yeah.
The word dynamite, you know what dynamite does, isn't it? And this verse tells us here, the Spirit of the Lord will come upon you when God touches you, and you will prophesy, that is to preach, to proclaim, to teach, to show men the way. This will happen to you once these signs are fulfilled, and whatever your hand find to do, do it. Come on now. Whatever your hand what? Find to do what? Do it. Why? Look at the verse. Whatever your hand find to do, do it. Because the verse says, God is with you. Let me tell you something. I'll go anywhere, do anything, say anything, climb any mountain, go in any valley, cross any ocean, when God is with me.
Amen.
I have good news for you.
Yes.
And the good news is that when God is with you, defeat is impossible.
Yes.
Where is everybody?
Yes.
And victory is inevitable.
Yes.
And every time I read that statement, I feel like shouting hallelujah.
Amen.
I was on Highway 95 in good old Miami. Anybody from Miami here? And I was driving my little meager Honda. That's all the pastor could afford. And as I drove along, I noticed at the side a beautiful, brand new Cadillac. The Cadillac was red. And I noticed the hood was up. an indication that something was wrong. Threw over to see if I could offer help, only to discover that this was the latest Cadillac white interior. Huh? Red color outside. Well, that grabs anybody's attention. It was the most expensive of them. But you see, it was at the roadside stall because they ran out of gas. And the moment I saw that, Brother Eric, I said to myself, here is an illustration for a sermon. Because you see, it does not matter how expensive the Cadillac is. If it has no gas, it goes nowhere. The gas we need today is the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. That will bring us revival. Come on now. Gasless Cadillac. My little Honda had gas. And it could move along beautifully. And because empowered men are spirit-filled, they are also action-driven. By the way, there is no unction without action. And when the Spirit fills our lives, there is action. The Cadillac begins to run because it has gas. Thank God for the Holy Spirit. What do you say? May I suggest to you this morning, my dear brothers, be careful in your growth in life. Be careful with the rock and chair syndrome. Just what do you mean by that? I'll tell you what I mean. I was in my home country, the Dominican Republic. Anybody from that country? And had a week of prayer at the Adventist University. At the end of that beautiful session, 8 days of marvelous relationship with God, they gave me a gift. You'd never believe it. 2 rocking chairs. Made of beautiful Dominican mahogany. So I got these 2 chairs and I said, why would they give me an active minister 2 chairs, rocking chairs? Well, I had to be gracious, so I took them home, set them up, one here, one there. And then my wife and I decided to test them out. So we sat there and we began to rock and rock and rock and rock. And after a while, both of us fell fast asleep. That's the idea. And at that juncture, I woke up. I looked at my wife, and she was awake by then. And she said to me, George, why are we doing this? I have my garden to look about. I have all these things to do, and here we are rocking. You know, the problem with that was this, that the rocking chair keeps you busy, but it doesn't get you anywhere. So when you go back to your church, it is not sufficient to have seminars. Right? It is not sufficient to teach people how to do what, and when they go home, they do nothing. Revival calls for the empowerment of the Spirit, which keeps us going forward in faith. And unction is always followed by what?
Action.
Forward going action. And I have a whole sermon on that coming up tomorrow, God's willing. So I've told you already that the touch of God does something for us. It transforms us, isn't it? The second thing that God's touch does is it empowers us for action.
Amen.
Come on now. What's the first?
Transforms.
What's the second?
Empowers
us. real power to go forward in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And by the way, I like what the verse says. Go prophesy. Whatever your hand finds to do, what?
Do it.
Do it. For I am what? With you. I have good news for you, men, my dear brothers. God will be with us in every circumstance.
Amen.
Yeah? In the flood, he's with us. In the fire, he'll be with us. In success, he's with us. In prosperity, he's with us. And even in our moments of weakness, he's there to enable us. He's always with us, isn't that right?
Amen.
Praise God. I like that text in Matthew 28. Lo, I am what?
With you.
Sometimes.
Always.
Always. Do you believe that?
Yes, Lord.
Always. Daniel was thrown and his companions. These young men were thrown in the fiery furnace. You remember the narrative?
Yes.
They were thrown in the fiery furnace, and there they were. And the next morning, King Nebuchadnezzar came to inspect the ashes. And when he came, he was shocked. What did he see? He said, didn't we throw three men in the fire, bound? Notice the emphasis? Bound in the fire. Now, if you're bound in the fire, you've got to burn. But he says now, I see what? Four men loosed and walking. And then he added this, and the fourth man looked like the Son of God. Listen, men, that same Son of God is with us today.
Amen.
On the highways, in the byways, in your struggles, in your conflicts, in your good days, in your bad days, he is always with us. What do you say?
Amen.
This brings me to the third thing that God's touch does. First, it does what? Transforms us. Makes us new men with a new heart. Don't leave that out. New men with a new heart. Secondly, it empowers us, fills us with the gas of the Holy Spirit so we can move forward in faith. Right? The third thing it does, it unifies us. You like that? By the way, a disorganized group of men is a gang.
Right?
But this verse tells us, and there went with him a band of men.
Band.
Whose hearts God had what? What does the word band suggest to you? Come on now, talk back. Why are you pointing to these fellows? I tell you, that trumpet is like Gabriel's. Guitar, no? But you play it together, there's harmony, isn't that right?
Yeah.
I appeal to you men, go back home to your churches, harmonize.
Yes.
Speak as one.
Yes.
What do you say?
Yes.
One in doctrine.
Yes.
I said one in doctrine.
Yes.
Don't follow the offshoots.
Yes.
Thank God for this message.
Yes.
I said thank God for this message.
Yes.
Thank God for Adventism.
Yes.
Thank God for the spirit of prophecy.
Yes.
Thank God for the direction of this church.
Yes.
Thank God for its mission.
Yes.
Thank God for its message.
Yes.
And hallelujah for its destiny.
Yes.
Man. Stay united.
United.
Stay united. We were in Antigua, the homeland of my daddy. And we went to visit, we were having a crusade. We went to visit a Moravian preacher. And after we talked, we said to him, strength is unity. And he says, and unity is victory. And I thought of that many times. And I said to you this morning, if we remain united in Christ, amen?
Yes.
United in doctrine.
Yes.
United in the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Victory is assured.
Amen.
Wow. What a compelling portrait of unity, a band of men whose hearts God had touched. Mm-hmm. And that is descriptive of this group of men here in this convention this morning. What do you say?
Amen.
Unity is always the product of the transformation and empowerment of the Holy Spirit. Saul and his royal entourage went home as a band of men united. Mm-hmm. I want you to go home that way. What do you say?
Amen.
And when you go home, your pastor must see.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Your wife must see.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Your fiancés must see.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
The community must see. The church members, that we are united in Christ.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Going forward in faith. I like the way the Spanish version of this text puts it. Un ejército de hombres. Mm-hmm. An army of men.
Woo.
Real men. Mm-hmm. I won't say more about real men until the midday service. Mm-hmm. I have something on that. An army, a band of men, denotes cohesiveness. What do you say?
Yes.
Unity is the hallmark of the Holy Spirit's endowment. You know, I did a study of the word unity in the book of Acts. And I came up with some amazing insights. This is a portrait of a God who unifies his people.
Yes.
When we are transformed radically, amen?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
When we are empowered fully, when we are united totally in Christ, mm-hmm. defeat becomes impossible. I said impossible. And victory is inevitable. Go home with that. Chew on it. Digest it. Assimilate it. Regardless of ethnicity. Regardless of nationality. Regardless of social status. Regardless of linguistic differences. We are one in spirit.
Amen.
Amen. We are one in doctrine. We are one in faith. We are one in mission. And we are one in the blessed hope. Men, I don't know about you, but every time I read the newspapers, every time I look at the television, every time I look at my iPad, every time I look at my phone, because everywhere there's news, and all of it is bad news. Bad news. But thank God, you are the possessors of good news.
Amen.
The good news is that a long time ago on a hill called Calvary, Jesus died for us.
Amen.
And the Christ who died for us is today interceding for us in the heavenly sanctuary.
Amen.
And the greatest part of the good news is he's coming back again.
Amen.
I said he's coming back again.
Amen.
And that coming must be very soon.
Yes.
Very soon we shall see the King. In the book of Acts, I noticed something there about the church. And as I see this beautiful display of men here today, I long for the opportunity to know that we have experienced the Pentecostal unity.
Yes.
Amen? And I notice here the following. After Pentecost touched their lives, there was cohesiveness.
Yes.
There was fellowship. Come on now.
Yes.
They were centered in the Lord Jesus Christ. They prayed together.
Yes.
Come on now.
Yes.
Prayed together. They witnessed together.
Yes.
They fellowshiped together.
Yes.
They suffered together. They celebrated together. They were unified together. And their common slogan was together. I'm going to give you an assignment. Take the book of Acts. Go through it. And see how many times you find the word fellowship.
Okay.
Together.
Okay.
Together. And I challenge you today, my dear beloved brothers. Go back home united.
Amen.
Go back home united in Christ Jesus.
Yes.
It was during the years of the Vietnam War that Richard M. Nixon, ran for the presidency.
Yes.
Some here were not born yet. But he told a story that I shall never forget. He was in one section of this country making his speech, and right up in front there was a little girl with a plaque. And the plaque read, "Mr. Nixon, bring us together." This country was divided. And by the way, it was no more divided then than it is today. And the appeal was by the little girl, "Mr. Nixon, what? Bring us together." And I thank God for the theology of Scripture. Because a long time ago on Calvary, Christ brought us together.
Amen.
I said he brought us together.
Amen.
You know, my friend Frank L. Peterson, the author of that beautiful book, Hope of the Race, used to say this. I'll never forget it, because he made this statement at my ordination so long ago, I wouldn't even tell you how long it was. But he said this, "George, when you engage in ministry, bring the church together, because God doesn't have white children. God does not have black children.
Amen.
God doesn't have Cuban children."
Amen.
Sorry, Cubans. "God doesn't have Jamaican children. God doesn't have Dominican children. God just has children."
Amen.
Go back home, united as one.
Yes.
We are brothers in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
What do you say?
Yeah.
And there went with him a band of men,
yes,
whose hearts,
yes,
God had touched.
Amen.
Close this service this morning. You know, I feel the urge to keep on. But you know, if enough is sufficient, more can't be better. But I want to leave these words with you. May this be your testimony, men. Where are you? May this be your testimony. Since I met this blessed Savior, since he cleansed and made me whole, I will never cease to praise him. I will shout it while eternity rolls. He touched me. Come on, men. He touched me. Oh, he touched me. And oh, the joy that filled my soul. Something happened. And now I know he touched me and made me whole.
Amen.
How many of you here want to say this morning, "Elder Brown, thank God for this message"?
Amen.
Thank God that when he touches us, he transforms us, makes us new. Thank God when he touches us, he empowers us. Cadillacs with gas. Thank God when he touches us, he unites us. And you'd like to say, "Thank God that you touched me."
Amen.
How many would like to say that today? "Touch me, Lord. Touch me." The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord touch you today and transform you. The Lord empower you today with his Spirit. May the Lord unite you until you can sing hallelujah. Thank God he touched me.
Amen.
And made